Good afternoon. Today we will continue with the next topics of Unit 1, which is HDSL. So in the case of HDSL, first we have to focus on the term DSL. Now what is DSL? DSL is simply Digital Subscriber Line. So Digital Subscriber Line is another way of communication or transmission. So it is a way of transmission in the case of data communication, and it is used to transfer internet to copper wire telecommunication. So we transfer internet through copper wire. So in this case, instead of twisted pair, we are using copper wire, and along with the along with the coaxial cables that we have, Digital Subscriber Line is also another way to provide broadband internet access. So to provide broadband, internet service providers use this Digital Subscriber Line. Now, what is the purpose of the Digital Subscriber Line? So the first and foremost, obviously, is the high speed. Whenever you are transmitting the data, the bandwidth or the speed should be high. So that is the most important thing. And the next will be to achieve the facility of getting frequency that is uninterrupted. So basically, the benefit of DSL is that it makes use of your existing telephone or phone wiring, and you do not have to upgrade to your phone system, and it is cost effective. So DSL is cost effective. And it is best in the case of connectivity. So the connectivity will be good. And DSL, Digital Subscriber Line, makes use of the modems that is provided by the service providers. And in the case of Digital Subscriber Line, we can use both telephone line and the internet at the same time. And it is because the voice is transferred on other frequency. So in the case of telephone line and internet, we are talking about voice transmission and data transmission. So how can two transmissions be done on the same line? So the frequency, as we have seen, it makes use of the frequency division multiplexing. That is, voice transmission make use of another frequency and the data transmission makes use of a different frequency. So both the voice and the digital signals are transferred on different frequencies. And the users also have the options of choosing between different speeds and pricing. So if we have high speed, then we will have high pricing, and depending upon that, users can choose. And DSL internet service works over a limited physical distance, so it can be considered as a disadvantage. This is a disadvantage, limited physical distance. Then we have, it remains unavailable in many areas where the local telephone infrastructure is not supported. So we need telephone wiring, that is the copper wiring that is put for telephones, and that wiring is also used for your internet connections. So if that service is not available, obviously then your data transmission may not happen. And the connection is faster for receiving data than it is for sending the data. So for like basically the downloading speed is higher and the uploading speed is lower. It can be said in this way. We will have the option of having both of them equally, but usually we consider this case of downloading speed being higher. That is, the downstream speeds are faster and the upstream speeds are slower. So now, in this case, before seeing this HDSL, we will be seeing ADSL, which is Asymmetrical Digital Subscriber Line. So Asymmetrical Digital Subscriber Line, we also have the Symmetrical Digital Subscriber Line, that is SDSL. What is SDSL is basically both upstream, that is uploading and downloading speeds, are equal. That is your symmetrical digital subscriber line. So if it is providing, suppose 2 Mbps of upstream connection, then it will provide the same for the downstream connection. And it is mostly preferred by small organizations. But what is largely used very much is asymmetrical digital subscriber line. So what it has is, it provides a wider frequency range for downstream. So here, in the case of asymmetrical, the downstream speed is very high. Speed is quite high while compared to the upstream speed. So, and it is because most users, so generally when we see, most users download more data than they upload. So we don't upload much data, but we usually download more data. So that is why this is the most common variation used in the digital subscriber line, that is asymmetrical digital subscriber line. Now, so it is the implementation and deployment of a high-speed wide area public digital network. So in that implementation, the most challenging part is the link between the subscriber and the network. So suppose if you have a network and from there you have to give it to the subscriber, then the best option is for a digital subscriber line. So in the case of digital subscriber line, if we have billions of subscribers for a single network, then in that case, for each subscriber, we cannot have a new cable. So that is why, instead of having twisted pair wires, we started using the already installed wires, that is the links that were installed to carry voice signals. Those wires are capable of transmitting signals of 1 MHz also. So ADSL is the most widely used in the new modem technology. So among all the digital subscriber lines, ADSL is mostly used. So what it does is, it uses the already existing twisted pair cable, and it is asymmetric. Asymmetric means bigger downstream, that is bigger, higher downloading speed than the uploading speed. And it uses, as I said, frequency division multiplexing. So it reserves the lowest frequency for voice over, and it also uses echo cancellation or frequency division multiplexing to give 2 bands. And it has a range of about 5.5 kilometers. So basically, the term is asymmetric, as we have seen, is for the higher downstream speed. And it was originally needed for the video on demand service, that is for video watching. So that, for that reason, it was originally created. But however, since the advent of the internet, we have seen that the downstream usage is more than the upstream usage. And so it is typically the user requires a higher capacity of download speed than the upstream, that is the upload speed. So user transmissions that we usually have, that is whenever the user is uploading, he simply is writing. So these days it may be different, but in the earlier days, the user simply used to have send a few emails or write a few messages. For that reason, the upload speed was not needed. So with web traffic and for download speed, you know that if you're searching or even if you're typing anything on Google, it provides a list of audios, videos and images. For that reason, ADSL is a perfect fit for the internet requirement. And it uses frequency division multiplexing, as we have seen. It reserves the lowest for plain old. So this POTS is actually plain old telephone service or voice communication. And it uses either echo cancellation or the frequency division multiplexing to allocate 2 bands. So it has 2 bands. One is for the uploading and the other is for the downloading. And it uses frequency division multiplexing within the upstream and the downstream bands. And the disadvantage, the ADSL provides a range of up to 5.5 kilometers, depending on the diameter of the cable and its quality. Now, after that, we will be seeing directly what is XDSL. So This is the ADSL channel configuration. So 0 to 25 hertz is for the telephone service. Then 25 to 200, that is up to 2 Mbps, is for upstream. And then we have the downstream large speed or the higher frequency is assigned for the downloading. And in the case of echo cancellation, so basically when you are downloading and uploading, there might be an echo cancellation. That is, there might be an interference. So for that reason, it uses the echo cancellation. Now, what is HDSL? So ADSL is one of the schemes. In the case of HDSL, all the digital subscriber lines together are collectively referred as HDSL. So in here, instead of X, we may have A, S, H, etc. So all of them collectively, digital subscriber lines collectively are known by this term HDSL. So the first one that we will be seeing is high data rate digital subscriber line. So this is developed in the 1980s to provide more cost effective means of delivering the data. So basically, when we are talking about HDSL, it uses a 2B1Q coding. So this is a type of coding on the twisted pair, and to provide data rate of up to 2 Mbps. So it has a data rate of up to 2 Mbps over the distance 3.7 kilometers. This is the high data rate digital subscriber line. And the next we have is single line digital subscriber line. So single line digital subscriber line is HDSL. So this is a replacement for the HDSL. It is suitable for residential subscribers because it requires two twisted pairs. And HDSL was developed using the same 2B1Q coding on a single twisted pair wire. Here we were using dual twisted pair wire. So here, single twisted pair wire for residential subscribers. These are the subscribers. And it has the same 2 Mbps and over a distance of 3.7 kilometers. Now we have very high data rate digital subscriber line. So this is the newest one, VDSL. So it is the signaling technique is DMT QAM. This DMT is basically discrete multi-tone. So discrete multi-tone is a multiple carrier signals at different frequencies. So DMT is basically discrete multi-tone. It uses multiple carrier signals at different frequencies. That is what frequency division multiplexing is, right? So sending some of the bits on each channel. And DMT is basically used for the transmission. And what is this QAM is? Quadrature amplitude modulation. So this actually quadrature amplitude modulation is converting the local analog signal by using this technique. What is this basically is assigning different number of bits per transmitted signals. So for each signal, suppose in one signal we may have 2 bits, in the other signal we may have 3 bits. So in this way, for each signal we will be assigning different number of bits. So in the case of very high data rate DSL, that is VDSL, it uses these two techniques. And what it does is, the objective of this VDSL is to provide a higher data rate without sacrificing the distance. So at the same distance, it has to provide a high data rate more than 2 Mbps. So VDSL, it does not use echo cancellation, but it provides different bands for different services. That is for voice transmission, it will provide a different band, and from data transmission, it will have a different band. So in this case, VDSL is basically for higher data rates. Now, the next topic is asynchronous and synchronous transmission. So whenever we are talking about transmission. So transmission is basically the data transmission that we have been looking from the first topic. So most digital messages are longer than just a few bits. And usually you don't write messages in bits, right? You write messages in the form of text or voice or video images. So in that case, obviously the size, data size will be larger. So it is not, neither practical nor economical to transfer all the bits of a long message simultaneously. So you won't transfer the message as 11010, etc. So that message is broken into smaller parts, as we have seen in our OSI and TCP/IP models. Each message is broken into frames, segment, etc. So, and transmitted sequentially. So bit serial transmission conveys a message one bit at a time through a channel. So now we are seeing the bit serial transmission where we transfer each bit. So suppose we have one, then one is transmitted, then zero is transmitted, etc. And each bit represents a part of the message. Now, bit serial data transmission, that is individual bits are then reassembled at the destination. So suppose at the destination, we have received a one first, then zero again and one. So all of them are assembled together until and unless we don't receive all the bits, your message will not be converted. Okay. So in general, one channel will pass only one bit at a time. Thus, bit serial transmission is necessary in data communications if only a single channel is available. Suppose if we have one channel, then on that channel, we can have only transmission of one bit. So bit serial transmission is normally called as the serial transmission and is the chosen communication method in many computer peripherals. So whenever in the old times we had to transfer a message, that is when the technologies which existed today did not exist earlier, then we use the bit serial data transmission. The next is byte serial data transmission. So byte serial transmission conveys or it transfers 8 bits at a time through 8 parallel channels. So basically at a time we are transferring 8 bits. For that 8 bits we will need obviously 8 channels. Although the raw transfer rate is 8 times faster than in bit serial transmission, 8 channels are needed. And since we need 8 channels, obviously the cost will increase 8 times. So when distances are short, so for short distances, both techniques are feasible. If we transfer one bit at a time, it will travel quickly and that is okay. If you're using 8 channels over a short distance also, it is all right to use parallel channels for high data rates. Now, what happens when the distances are longer? So these actually examples are not related, so we will skip this. Now, the synchronization technique. So whenever we are transferring the data, obviously, it needs to be synchronized. So in the case of synchronization, we may have two types of transmission. One is asynchronous transmission and the other is synchronous transmission. So in the case of asynchronous transmission, data is sent in the form of byte or character. Each character is transmitted separately with separate synchronization information. This type of transmission is often used in situations when characters are generated at random intervals, such as when a user types at a terminal. So suppose you're typing commands to the computer, then in that case, we use this asynchronous transmission. That is all the bits randomly, so the computer may not know which bit is coming next. So for that reason, it uses asynchronous transmission. And in asynchronous transmission, all the bits that comprise a character are framed and then sent as a single transmission string. So basically, in the case of asynchronous transmission, all the bits are framed together and then they are sent as a single transmission. So here in the case of asynchronous transmission, we have to know that data is sent in the form of either byte or even a single bit, that is a character. And this transmission is for half duplex, that is one-way lane, half duplex transmission. And in this transmission, start bits and stop bits are added with the data. So we add start bit and stop bit. And this does not require synchronization. Basically, at the end, when the entire data is framed together. So here, if I am giving you the way the frame is set for the asynchronous transmission, we will have a sender S. And at the beginning, we will have a Here we may have data, and for the data we will be having a stop bit and a start bit and the receiver. So this way the synchronous transmission takes place. Now we will look at the So the clocks of the transmitter and the receiver are not synchronized. So suppose if the sender and the receiver are transmitting the data, in this case the clock of the sender and the receiver, so suppose that 1 second it is sending the data character one, and the receiver might be so there will be a transmission time, right? So transmission might take 1 second more, and the receiver is receiving the data at 2 seconds. So in this case, at what time the sender is sending data is not synchronized to at what time the receiver is receiving the data. So, but the receiver needs to know when the character begins and ends. So in this case, the receiver should know, right, where your message is starting and ending. For this reason, the character's bit string is themed with start and stop bit. So start bit resets the receiver clock so that it matches the transmitter. So whenever the sender sends the first bit, that is the start bit, the receiver will reset its clock. And the clock only needs to be accurate enough to stay in sync for the next 8 to 11 ticks. What is a stick is basically, if for the next 8 to 11 bits, it should be in sync with the sender. And at least one stop bit, so at the end, one stop bit is added to mark the end of the character. So if we are sending a character also, it will obviously be around 8 bits or 16 bits or 32 bits, right? So for that reason, the sender and the receiver must sync their clocks. So that is done with the help of start and stop bits. Now, in the case of asynchronous transmission, one problem will be error detection. So how do we detect the errors? So one way to detect errors in asynchronous transmission is to add an extra bit, which is called a parity bit. Okay. So parity bit is added to the end of each character in a frame, so that we know the message is matching or not. Now, what is the final conclusion? Asynchronous transmission is uncomplicated and inexpensive, but slow. And for each character, we need to have a start bit, stop bit, and a parity bit. So overhead is high for each character. Now, the next is synchronous transmission. So in some applications, it is necessary for large blocks of data, such as the contents of a disk file, to be transmitted. So for that reason, synchronous transmission is more efficient rather than using asynchronous transmission. And data are usually buffered and transmitted as an entire message or stream. For this reason, clocks on both sides must maintain synchronization. This is accomplished by using a synchronizing signal, and a clocking can be included in the data signal. Now, in synchronous transmission, data is sent in the form of blocks. So here we send it in the form of blocks or frames. So this transmission is usually of full duplex, that is two-way street. And between the sender and the receiver, the synchronizing is very compulsory. And in the case of synchronous transmission, there is no gap between the data. And it is more efficient and more reliable than asynchronous transmission. So better or more efficient and more reliable than the asynchronous transmission. Okay. So now what happens is, in the case of synchronous transmission, there is no start bit, stop bit, or parity bit. The data is sent in the form of blocks. So there is we have a block of data, and that data is sent together without any gap. Now, if we see the difference between synchronous and asynchronous transmission, so the first one obviously will be, we have blocks or frames of data. In the case of asynchronous, we have bytes or characters of data. Then this synchronous transmission is fast. Second point, it is fast. Asynchronous transmission is slow, because we have we have overheads, that is start bit, stop bit, etc., and there is a gap. So for that reason, it is slow. And obviously, if this is fast, it will be costly too, while this is economical or inexpensive. Now, the time interval is constant. That is, each message or each block will take, suppose, each block is taking suppose 1 second, then there will be a time interval or a gap. If the message is continuous, there will not be any gap. But in the case of asynchronous transmission, suppose the user is transmitting the message through keyboard to the computer, that is when he is typing on the terminal, then he may type a key, he may press a key and then wait for a few seconds and may not press a key. So there, the transmission between, and that is in the case of asynchronous transmission, there is a gap. So next we have, and also time interval is not constant, it is random. And efficient use of transmission line is done in the case of synchronous, but while in asynchronous transmission, transmission line remains empty. Okay, so these are the few basic differences that you can even write by just studying these paragraphs. So in the case of synchronous transmission, error detection is done through cyclic redundancy check. That is, the CRC, it processes a data on the basis of an algorithm. So we have a CRC algorithm actually. So this result, cyclic redundancy check, is done on the block or a frame. And then if the result is correct, then it is attached to, we have a CRC field, which says whether the result, cyclic redundancy check gave you the correct result or not. And any difference is assumed to mean frame damage. So suppose in the case of cyclic redundancy check, we got some kind of difference, then it means there is some kind of frame damage during transmission and retransmission. And it provides more efficient, higher speed and improved error detection. But obviously it will be expensive and complex. So now the next topic is introduction to wired and wireless LAN. So this will be taken up in the next class, and I conclude the class today here. Thank you.